name is Toby. I'm here to testify to God's faithfulness in my life. Yesterday, 17th of November, make it exactly 2 years that I got to New Zealand. Yesterday, and why I'm thanking God is because the risk I took to come to New Zealand, I think that's one of the expensive risks any human being can take. Because while I was coming here, I didn't know anyone in New Zealand. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know nobody's going to come and pick me at the airport. Nothing. I just took that risk. And here I am today, 2 years down the line, God has been so faithful. So that's why I'm here to thank God for my life.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. He's thanking God for keeping him for 2 years in New Zealand. Hallelujah. In the spirit of the Make a Friend for Jesus, we have vests which the church have actually printed for each and every one of us for the activity that has been slated for the 26th of December. RCCG Beautiful Place is an arm of the RCCG Worldwide. Every 26th of December, what is normally done is go fishing. Let's go a fishing, where we normally go and evangelize and get and bring in more souls to God. Hallelujah. Amen. So the church has actually printed vests to be used on that day. Just at the entrance of the church, we'll find those vests there. And the church has been able to subsidize the payment of the vest, but we still have some there. And we implore any of us that has not gotten, and if you have people that you think can be part of us, that can join us in evangelizing on that 26th of February, which is actually a tentative date, we want you to please pick up those vests and get it across to them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And also, like we mentioned, we are advised, we now have a special testimony booklets, like a paper where we can write our testimony. So, like we mentioned, we overcome by the words of our testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. So, we are implored to, you'll be given the paper to write down your testimony and spots, and you will pick that at the entrance of the church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
May
the Lord bless us as we listen to this testimony, to this announcement.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the mighty name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We're going to read the Bible this morning, and we're looking at Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16.
And he said also unto his disciples, there was a certain rich man which had a steward, and the same was accused unto him that he had wasted his goods. And he called him and said unto him, how is it that I hear this of thee? Give an account of thy stewardship, for thou mayest be no longer steward. Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. I cannot dig. To beg, I am ashamed. I am resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. cannot serve God and mammon. And the Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard all these things, and they derided him. And he said unto them, Ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knoweth your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it. And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass than one tittle of the law to fail. Whosoever putteth away his wife and marrieth another committeth adultery. And whosoever marrieth her that is put away from her husband committeth adultery. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham saith unto him, They have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they would repent. And he said unto him, If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded though one rose from the dead.
May the Lord bless the reading of the word in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Well, rising up to sing our congregational song, Rescue the Perishing, Care for the Dying, the choir.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Please, may have our seat. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
How many of us know Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And whatever he says is the truth. And in John 15, verse 5, he said, without him, we can do nothing. Like he's the vine and we are the branches. Without Jesus, we cannot do anything. Like the life we are living right now is because of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Do you agree with me that Jesus is everything?
Yeah.
Like without him, we can do nothing. So the choir is about to sing a song. It's a very simple song. If you know, you can join us and sing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I can't live without you.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You are welcome to service in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Can I have a louder amen?
Amen.
Can you say after me, I believe and confess,
I believe and confess
that as I will be taught the word of God today,
my mind,
you'll be fruitful.
My spirit,
you'll be alive.
My spirit,
you'll be alert.
My body,
you'll be in health. Say my understanding, you produce result. You bring forth fruit. My life, you'll not be the same again. I will be changed. I'll be charged. I'll be transformed. I'll be blessed in the name of Jesus. Clap your hands and celebrate God. I remember a story I once shared with you in the service here. It's the story of an American young boy. I don't know if you still remember the story. The young boy loves creating crafts. And what he did was that he created a boat, a wooden boat. And underneath the boat, he crafted and wrote his name. But something happened to the boat. The boat got missing. How? The boy sometimes will fill the bathtub with water and will make his little boat to rock on the water. He enjoys it. And how many of you remember the story? Okay. He actually enjoyed it so much as his boat rocks to the rocks back and forth. But one day, he wasn't satisfied with the bathtub again. So he decided to have a bigger adventure. Somebody say a bigger adventure. So he took that little boat and took it to the sea. And he expected it's going to have the same effect of rocking back and forth. Well, for a long time, for some time, let me say, the boat actually was rocking back and forth. But it got to a time, the boat sailed beyond its control. So what happened to him? He lost his boat. Months passed, years passed. Perhaps he forgot about the boat until one day he was passing by a store with a glass display. And right through the glass, he was passing by with his father, with his dad. And right through the glass, he noticed a wooden boat. So he moved closer and he said, "This boat looks like my boat." So he told his dad, he said, "This boat looks like my boat." And his dad said, "No, fine. Let's go inside." So they went inside. Actually, the boat had been put up for sale. So he grabbed the boat. And the first thing he did was to look underneath to see where he crafted his name. And when he did that, he saw his name. And he was so happy. He was so joyful. He shouted, little boat, I got you at last." So he wanted to run out of the shop, but his father grabbed him and said, "No, son, it's not going to be like that again. We've got to pay for it." So his father brought out his wallet and made payment for the boat. In joy, when the boy got out of the store, he lifted up the boat and shouted and said, little boat, you are mine now, and you are double mine." And he said, "Why? Because I make you, and because I bought you." Clap your hands and celebrate God. And that story described to us actually what Jesus Christ did for us. You are Jesus's because, number one, he make you. He made you because, number two, he chose to buy you with his own blood. Hallelujah.
Amen.
John chapter 15. And after he's going to buy you, after he shed his blood for you, what will be the outcome? John chapter 15. John chapter 15, I'm reading verse 15. Jesus said unto his disciples, and to every one of you under the sound of my voice, henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I've called you friends. Everybody say friends. For all things that I've heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Can we read it together, church? Want to go? Henceforth, I call you not servants. Come on, say, I am not a servant. For the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. What a great privilege. Can you lift up your hands and clap once again? That the Son of God, who came down to become the Son of Man, to make us sons of men, choose to make us servants, am I right? No. He chooses to make us friends. Clap your hands and celebrate it once again. So say after me, say the Son of God, came down to become the Son of Man, to make me a Son of God. Let's bow down our heads for a word of prayer. Father, as we come into this service, and as we look at this revelation briefly, I ask Holy Spirit that that which you have intended, the very words and the very impact of this revelation, will be made known unto your people in Jesus' name. Take authority over every unclean spirit and every bird of the air that snatches and steals the word. They are in subjection right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church will say a louder amen. Actually, just like the moderator or the person that did the announcement told us, we're starting a campaign in this church. And I want you to be part of the campaign. I want you to be part of the campaign. And if you're going to be part of the campaign, if you're going to be actual participant of the campaign, what I'm talking about this morning is going to actually help you to be a good participant. Praise the name of the Lord. Have you ever thought in your mind that you go to stores? I was looking at an advert yesterday, and a particular store in Christchurch in New Zealand was advertising that they have the cheapest food to sell. And I asked myself, that's how life is. Everything in life has a value. Everything in life has a price. You can't walk into a place and not get and just pick something for free. Even in Freetown, in Sierra Leone, in Africa, things are not free. Do you know that? You've got to pay for it. So you ask yourself, if I can pay for the food that I eat, good. If I can pay for the clothes that I put on, good. What is the value of my soul? Can you ask the person, how much is the worth of your soul? Do you know? Perhaps a dollar? That would be too cheap. $1 billion? That would be very expensive, you know. But can you sell your soul for $1 million? No, that's also on the high side. Well, let's make it $100 million. Is anyone here that is ready to sell his life or soul or body or spirit for $100 million? None of us. So this morning, we are starting a three-service series. We're going to have some break in between. And the first in the series is the worth of the soul. Or you put it in the accounting language, the value of a soul. And you have to look at it in this way. Number one, there are people outside there that have a soul. Number two, you, that you're under the voice of, or under the sound of my voice this morning, you have a soul. Can you tell me, church, what is the value of your soul? In Mark chapter 8, Jesus tried to help us. In Mark chapter 8, the value, the worth of a soul. Jesus tried to help our imagination. And he says, henceforth, in Mark chapter 8, verse 36. Mark chapter 8, and in verse 36, if you're there, shout amen. For what shall be profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Hallelujah. What did the Bible say, church? Can you read it with me? For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain this whole world and lose his own soul. Verse 37 and 38 put it better and explains this. Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? In other words, if I choose to write you a check this morning, how much will you be willing to collect for selling your soul to me? For giving over your soul to me? Verse 38, he says, whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Praise the name of the Lord. Human beings are made of three distinct personalities. We are made of the body, we are made of the spirit, and we are made of the soul. What did I say, church? We are made of the body, we are made of the spirit, and we are made of the soul. We are made of the body, we are made of the spirit, and we are made of the soul. What happens to our body? Genesis chapter 13, chapter 3 verse 19 tells us, if somebody dies today, just like we've read in the story in Luke chapter 16, like the rich man died and the Lazarus died. I'm coming back to that story. When somebody closes his eyes today and dies, what happens to his body? Genesis chapter 3, verse 19 tells us exactly what happens to your body. It says, from dust thou art, and unto dust, in the sweat of thy face, shall thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. So touch your skin and say, this is a dust. That's what the Bible calls you, skin. That's what the Bible calls you, body. Say, you are dust. You are made from dust. And when you die, you go back to dust. What happens to the spirit of man? Don't forget, man is a spirit. Man is a tripartite personality. Man is a spirit who lives in a body but have a soul. Say after the church, man is a spirit who lives in a body but have a soul. Now the first thing you want to know is, what happens to my body when it dies? The Bible says that body is made from dust, and unto dust is the body is going to return to. Let's find out from the second part of our tripartite personality, the spirit. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 tells us better. What happens to our spirit when the body goes back to the grave? When the body goes back to the dust, what happens to our spirit? Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and in verse 7. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and in verse 7. What actually happened is this. This shall the dust return to the earth, and as it was, the spirit does not belong to you. It belongs to God. It is actually the living being, the breath of life, the breath of God that was breathed unto you when your body was created from the dust, and that spirit goes back to where, George, look at the scripture. Then the dust shall return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Now you know what happens to the body? The body goes back to the what? To the dust. You know what happens to the spirit? The spirit goes back to what? To God. What happens to the soul? What happens to the soul? And what happens to the soul actually shows us the value of the soul. I want to let you know that the value of a soul is not measured in time, in terms of time. The value of a soul is not measured in terms of time. When a soul is lost, when a soul is created, it is created forever. And when a soul is lost forever. Not for a time, not for a season, not for a week, not for a year, not for a time, but for all eternity. For all eternity. for all eternity. For the worth of a soul is value, given the factor of timelessness. We have a young man in the days when he was very young, and he was one of the best brains that Nigeria has ever produced. He had first class in mathematics, and I listened to one of his teachings. I'm talking about 10 years ago, and he wants to describe to us how long is eternity? Because I told you, once a soul is created forever. It's not going to be measured by time. Once a soul is lost as well, it's lost forever. It's not going to be measured by time. And this vibrant, intelligent mathematician, one of the best brains that country ever produced, says, how long is eternity? Says, well, I will define it to you in two ways. He says, if you're going to ask a young man, a young boy, how young should the boy be? Can I have Temi? Temi, can you come around? Can you come around? Now, I'm not going to translate it into what he did. He did it using the model of the sea in his country, which was in Lagos. But I'm going to use it, in Christ Church now, I'm going to simulate how long eternity is with Sumner Beach. Sumner Beach is not far from here, but here we have this young girl, Temi. And I'm going to give you, the man wants to define to us how long eternity is. He said eternity is actually going to be the time that this young girl is going to take to go to Sumner Beach this morning and take a little cup in his hand or take a bucket in his hand, whatever he can take, she can carry, and go to Sumner Beach and pack all the sound in Sumner Beach and bring it over here. Today is the 18th day of November. So if Temi actually helps us to do that assignment, starting now, at this hour, almost from minutes to 12, how long do you think it's going to take Temi to pack all the sand from Sumner Beach right to Buchan Street? He says, well, maybe 1 year, maybe 2 years, maybe 10 years, maybe 100 years, maybe a million years. Well, I don't know. But you see, we're going to not be able to measure it until we send Temi to do it. Temi, would you like to do that assignment for us? No? Yes? We want to send you to Sumner Beach. We're going to give you a cup. And your assignment is that you're going to pack all the sound in Sumner Beach and bring it down to 90 Buchan Street. And then we're going to play with it. Are you ready for it? No? But the truth is this. She's not ready for it. But the truth is this. This is what the mathematician said. He says by the time Temi completes that assignment, eternity has just started. He says it this way again. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Let me go to your seat. He says this way again. He says the time that is going to take now, for some of you that don't like math, you may not love it, but you will appreciate it. He said the time is going to take Temi to finish that assignment is infinitesimal to the time taken for eternity to take, for the duration of eternity. Please look at somebody next to you and say, eternity is long. No, it's not long. Very long. You think it's very long? No, tell the person, very, very, very long. So it is important that your soul should be secure eternally. And it is also important that you arise to help other souls. Once a soul has been created, it has been created forever, it can never die, and that soul is going to last for all time. And when the body goes back to the grave and the spirit goes back to God, the soul will be protected out to stand to be judged for what the body has done. If the body has lived in righteousness, not your righteousness, but the righteousness of Christ, is going to be justified. But if the body has lived in sin, the soul is going to be condemned. Do you know, church? That was what happened to the rich man. Luke chapter 16. Let's quickly reflect that story as we close the service. Luke chapter 16. Jesus used a lot of parables to illustrate his messages. And actually, some theologians were trying to analyze this particular parable is unlike all other parables. All other parables that Jesus used, he never mentioned name. Read your Bible very well. All other parables, the parable of the tower, were there names? No. The parable of the lost sheep, were there names? No. The parable of the lost coin, were there names? So many parables, Jesus never mentioned names. But we are told, and it appears this looks like a true life event, because Jesus actually mentioned name. And he actually started in verse 21 by saying, a certain rich man. And you know Jesus, who teaches us that let your yes be yes and your no be no. I wouldn't think he's going to lie. In verse 20, it says, and there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with crumbs, which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dust came and licked his sore. Praise the name of the Lord. And it came to pass the beggar died. Praise the name of the Lord. So we are told in this passage of the scripture that in verse 21 and verse 19, there was a certain rich man. Verse 21, there was a certain Lazarus. So this looks like the story of two individuals. Please tell the person next to you, this story is real. What happened to these people? Five lessons. Number one, the rich man spent his lifetime feeding his body with the best food and the best lining, with the best clothing. He neglected a spirit man and he neglected his soul. Church, can I just encourage you? Ladies in the house, it's good to beautify your outward appearance, but if your inner beauty is not attractive, you are playing with the eternity of your soul. Can you spend 30 minutes to cover your face, but you can't spend 30 minutes in prayer? It's not a balanced spiritual life. Can you spend 50 minutes in garnishing your nails, but you can't spend 5 minutes in reading the Bible? Something is happening to you. You are spending too much time on that body. And where is the body going to?
To the dust.
That was what the rich man did. All that he did while he was on earth, was he spent time pampering his body. He spent time coloring his body. He spent time beautifying his body. Church, I'm not saying it is wrong to beautify your body. What I'm saying is this, that it is important that as you beautify your body, that you beautify your spirit as well. Come on, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I said, come on, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That it is important that as you beautify your body, you beautify your spirit as well. The rich man. Number two lessons that we learn from this rich man and the poor man is this. The poor man now made a request to the rich man. Said, rich man, can you please, you know I don't have food, can you please give me some of the food that you are eating? That's another thing that the rich man did. Another second lesson. The rich man said, no. These things are for my dogs, so you can't have the food. Praise the name of the Lord. Can I tell you this, church? The Bible says that if you close your ears to the cry of the rich, to the cry of the poor, say you will cry and God will not answer you. Do you know in Luke chapter 4 verse 18, Jesus said we must attend to the poor. The rich man deliberately ignored the yearnings of his soul. Let's look at the second point. Fourth. Praise the name of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Everybody say, preach the gospel to the poor. Everybody say, preach the gospel to the poor. The rich man, one of the things, one of the wrong ones, I'm on point three. The rich man died and his body buried, but his soul was transported into eternity immediately. The poor man also died and was buried. Both But both of their souls lived on. Only the soul out of this was will live forever. Now go back to point two. The rich man deliberately ignored the yearnings of his soul. For every sleeping soul has an inner craving for its maker. David said in Psalm 42, he says, my soul yearn for the Almighty. Let me tell you something. All these attempts to make ourselves happy, to make ourselves joyful, to have fun, is because of emptiness. Even after you have fun and you are still not, the fun is not fun. There's something you still don't have, God. Hallelujah. So, he ignored the craving of God. The rich man also ignored the cry of the poor. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Ezekiel chapter 3 tells it better. Ezekiel chapter 3. That's why what we are doing in this month of November, in this month of December, and for the rest of the existence of this church, making a friend for Jesus is important. Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 17. Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 17. Son of man, I've made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore, hear the word at my mouth and give them warning for me. And give them warning for me. Preach the gospel. Because every soul that is out there has been created to live forever. And the word is timeless. And the word is priceless. Look at verse 18. Praise the name of the Lord. When I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die. And you give him not warning nor speak to warn the wicked from his ways to save his life. The same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thy hand. Look at verse 19. Yet if thou warn the wicked and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but thou hast saved your soul. Can you tell the person next to you, it is important that your soul is saved? It is important that you also arise for the salvation of other souls. Look not at the beautiful young lady in your office. Look not at the beautiful guy, the handsome guy in the street. Look beyond the body. Look beyond the spirit. The body goes to the dust. The body goes to the ground. The spirit goes back to God. But that guy, that lady, has a soul that will live forever. Arise for the salvation of souls. And you that you are hungering the sound of my voice this morning, you have a soul that will live forever. Focus on your soul. Focus on your soul. Make sure that your soul is saved by the precious blood of Jesus. Because once that soul is created by God, it's going to live forever. What is the fourth lesson? Can you give us the fourth lesson, sir? What is the fourth lesson from this story? The story of the rich man and Lazarus. There will be no repentance. There will be no restitution for soul after death of everybody. And the spirit will return to God. The soul now left alone will stand for the sin committed in the body. For the wages of sin is death. It is appointed unto man to die once. And after this, comes what? Judgment. The last lesson. Before we pray. What is the last lesson? And you know what? The rich man now said, well, I've accepted my lot. I know that my soul cannot be saved again. But you know, I've got some brothers. And they are back at home. Can you please raise up an evangelist from here to go and evangelize them? It tells us a lot of things. Number one, there is no repentance for the soul of that rich man in heaven. Two, it also tells us there is no evangelism in heaven. There are people you will wish to evangelize when you get to heaven, but it will be too late. D.L. Moody, an American preacher, was one that prompted me to preach salvation to my mom. You know what I read from him? In one of his books, his classic on heaven, said the most generous of all sinners, we go to hell.
the most generous of all sinners. At that time, I was a young man, not married, and I asked myself, who was the best woman in my life? My mom. Very kind. She sold her heartly goods to send me to school. So I wonder, will this woman go to hell? No, I don't want her. So I started praying and preaching to her. Who is the person that is beloved in your life and you know they are not born again? Except the man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So this rich man wished that your co-worker that does not believe in God, that your friend that mocks God, that will be the opportunity to preach to them in eternity. You can't even send a prophet. Even if you say you have a calling to evangelize, you love to evangelize, that will be opportunity. Your soul cannot be evangelized. The soul of any man cannot be evangelized. Every request for evangelism will be turned off. So Abraham told him and said, it's not possible. He says, it's not possible. No prayer for the uncomfortable will be answered in eternity. No evangelism. No in eternity. Praise the name of the Lord. As we close, because of time, I kept on wondering in my heart. It's not part of the outline. And the Lord told me this morning, I said, do you know the reason why, the reason this rich man ended up in this situation? 3 things. Do you know the reason why? See, somebody said, you are either an harvest or an harvester. Are you with me, church? Are you an harvest or an harvester? Are you an harvest in the sense that you are either a sinner or a saint? You are either a mission field or a missionary. So 2 things will actually make, number one, somebody not to surrender his soul. 3 things will make his, number one, somebody not to surrender his soul to God. 3 things. Fear, excuse, procrastination. From this story, it's obvious that it wasn't that the rich man didn't believe there is eternity. He believed. But perhaps he was afraid. What will my rich friend say? He has gone to join those fools. Number 2, excuses. Excuses. Why you think you are not going to do it now? Why you think you are not going to preach the gospel now? Why you think you are not going to pray for the salvation of your soul now? Why you think you are not going to touch the blood of Jesus now? Why you think you are going to continue to play with sin? Ah, church, don't play with sin. Every secret sin is an open scandal in heaven. And the Bible says, continue in sin. But one day your sin will surely find you out. So fear can make somebody not to preach to unconverted soul. And fear can make a soul not even to surrender his life to Jesus Christ. Excuses also can do it. Church, when life is over and all is done, going to work will not matter again. Why are some people not in church this morning? Work. Why are some people not attending to their soul, especially in a developed Western culture, where you can make money the more you work? Work. Do you think this rich man will value work in eternity? No. Every excuse that keeps you away from reaching out to unsaved soul is no excuse in the sight of God. And every excuse that keeps you attending to the things that will make your soul to be eternally restful in the bosom of God is no excuse in the sight of God. Everybody, number 1, fear. Number 2, excuse. Number 3, procrastination. Oh, I will do it today. Oh, I will do it tomorrow. Oh, I will do it next week. When are you going to do it? And we all know that procrastination is a very good grave that buries every golden opportunity. What is my challenge to you this morning? If you are here under the sound of my voice, you are not sure of where your soul is going to dwell like this rich man, please let the blood of Jesus Christ come upon your soul. And if you are here and you are sure that your soul has been saved, please, from this day, from this week, from this month, for the rest of your life, arise and know that once a soul is created, it's created forever. And it's going to give account for what has been done in the body. This morning, I want us to rise up on our feet and say, every procrastination. Say after me, every procrastination. Every fear. And every excuse that binds my soul from God, from the blood, and other souls. In the name of Jesus, I cast you out of my life. I wanted to pray. Those are the three things that God wants us to deal with this morning. Every spirit of fear, every spirit of excuse, I will do it tomorrow. Every spirit of procrastination, I want you to deal with it. Deal with it. Deal with it. Deal with it. I want you to deal with it. I want you to deal with it. Every spirit of fear, every spirit of excuse, every spirit of procrastination, make a friend for Jesus. It's actually a privilege to make a friend for Jesus. It's actually a privilege to be a friend of Jesus. So we are talking about two things this morning. If your soul has been saved by the precious blood of the Lamb, if you can testify like that young man, little boy, you are mine, you are double mine, because I make you, because I bought you. If Jesus can say that concerning you, you become a friend for Jesus. And if you have become a friend from Jesus, a friend of Jesus, can you please go out and start making friends for Jesus? And start making friends for Jesus. 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 There's a song that we used to sing in those days, very touching song. It says, Kialeso, why do you linger, wandering from the fold of God? Yeah, you know that invitation, unprepared to meet your God. Kialeso,
thou must save and die.
this morning and you want to become a friend for Jesus, I want you to put your hand to your heart. Listen to me. Just want to pray for us briefly. Two things. It's either you are a friend for Jesus or you are making friends for Jesus. So if you want to make a vow to start making friends for Jesus because you are a friend for Jesus, raise up your hand. I'm going to pray with you. But if you are here this morning and you are not a friend of Jesus, it's either you are one of the two. It's either you are his friend and you are not. And because you are his friend, you have started making a friend for Jesus. So if you are here this morning and you are not a friend for Jesus, can I see your hand on your chest? You want to be a friend of Jesus. You want to be a friend of Jesus? Good. I want to believe that all of us are friends of Jesus. If you want to be, start making friends for Jesus, can I see your hand up this morning? You know that the soul of a man will live forever. You want to make a vow to start making friends for Jesus. Except you don't understand me. If you really understand me, you need to start making friends for Jesus. And you need to start reaching out to souls. Can I see your hand up? I'm going to pray with you. Is there anybody? You want to start making friends for Jesus? You want to start reaching out to souls? Amen. If you are born again, can I see your hand up? You are born again, can I see your hand up? You don't want to preach the gospel, put down your hands. You don't want to preach the gospel, put down your hands. Stop beating, please. If you are born again, can I see your hand up? If you are not born again, don't put up your hand. But if you know you are born again, can I see your hand? If you don't want to preach the gospel, can you drop your hands? That's what I'm saying. Making friends for Jesus. You are his friend now. You need to make other friends for Jesus. Can you come to the front if you want me to pray for you? But if you don't want to, just stay there. You want to start making friends for Jesus. And I want to pray for every one of us for grace. Stop playing. Let's have this serious moment. You want to preach the gospel? Can I see you in the front? You are born again and you want to preach the gospel? Can I see you in the front? We can continue to hide. We can continue to deceive ourselves. You don't want to preach, sit down. Don't worry yourself. But if you're a friend for Jesus, you are a friend of Jesus, and you want to make friends for Jesus, that's what we're talking about. Father, God of Abraham, God of Isaac, look at us as a church. Look at the potentials. Look at the good things that you have done in our lives. Some of us are ashamed. Some of us are reluctant. Some of us are, I don't understand. Perhaps you are even despising the world in your heart. I pray that God, please, don't let this world stand against us on the last day. Amen. If you don't understand, good. I pray, Lord, everyone that don't understand this morning, make them to understand. Amen. You have made us your friends by dying for us and shedding your blood. Please, Lord, help us to understand that there are other friends of yours out there in our way, places of work, and on the streets, and as we go out, help us to be able to reach out to them and bring them in. Thank you, faithful Father. I just commend you to everyone that have heard this word. Once again, Lord, let this word not stand against us. In Jesus' name, we pray. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Thank you very much, brother.
Return all the praises unto God. Return all the praises unto Him. Father, we bless you all evening.